To the rumor that we're going to 9 o'clock tomorrow morning, I'm afraid that's true. For some reason, we're going on to American hours. So you will have breakfast meetings. You probably have two breakfast meetings, and then we start at 9 o'clock. So apologies for that. But in response to urgent requests, tonight we'll finish much earlier than last night. So there's good news and bad news. And if I can find my good moderator, we are almost ready to go on this new session.
Thanks for your patience. Sorry to let you wait at the end of the day. You're probably all waiting to go to your room to go into town. But we have one more session, and it's called Connecting Devices and Information, New Insights Through Big Data. We have a big panel. We have six people in the panel, plus myself, which makes seven. The way we saw the panel was that we will first, each of us will introduce briefly their work, just to set the scene, just to give a bit of insight on what everybody's doing, how they are contributing to the topic. Then we will have a discussion with the panel, and afterwards we open the floor to you to also contribute. So I have just prepared a few slides. We've all heard about the datafication, the fact that everybody leaves a digital footprint, that there are sensors everywhere. I will just illustrate it with a quick example from tourism. We probably know this place. It's a famous place in the city of Prague. You see lots of people. One is making a call, one is switching on the smartphone, one is using a city map via the GPS on the phone. They're posting Facebook updates. They're viewing the Wikipedia page of the square that they're standing on. Or they're Googling already the cafe where they can go after the puppets have come out of this tower. One person booked a room via TripAdvisor. They're checking hotel websites directly. Or there's somebody checking in for the return flight the next day. Somebody just paid a souvenir in a souvenir shop with a credit card. Even the car that is parked there probably passed a few traffic loops, so the car also passed the sensor. We also know that the car is there, probably the license plate, nationality, region in Prague, whatever. Somebody probably switched on the heating in their rented apartment that is equipped with smart meters. Even the clock has its own Wikipedia page. So, I mean, everything that is there, everybody there, it's known. And of course, there's also somebody who took the picture and loaded it up to an album. So the background is a bit that we see that tourism statistics, it seems to be one of the early adopters of big data. I forgot to introduce myself. I work in Eurostat on tourism statistics, but we also have a big data task force that works on many different areas, also the legal institutional aspects. And we see that it always comes back to tourism because many of the sources are linked to human mobility, and tourism is a special case of human mobility. And it seems to be relatively easy to capture because, as we saw in the previous slide, tourists leave a trace just everywhere, with knowing it or without knowing it. We published a paper last year on this. If you want, you can find it on our website. This is actually also the title of the paper. I will just give one example of our work before going to the audience, just to give an idea. We've tried to do some work on improving the geographical granularity. We have data at national level, that's two level of countries. But of course, tourism is much destination-based decision-making, so we do need much more detailed data. This is just to show what we have now with our traditional surveys of accommodation establishments. It's data that's two. It's interesting, but of course, it doesn't tell the full story. Through all kind of mapping techniques and using auxiliary sources, TomTom points of interest and so on, we managed to scale this down to NUTS 3 data and even to 10-kilometer grids. And it's where we have the 10-kilometer grids that it becomes interesting because you can clearly see the capital regions, the coastal regions. When you look at France, you see clearly the lines of the Rhône River and the Loire River, which is typically the border between two areas. So in traditional statistics, you won't even be able to capture this. So, this was the next one, sorry. This is the last slide. Of course, all of this, there's lots of challenges, and this probably already brings us to the discussion we'll have afterwards. One of the challenges, it's addressing the user needs. I mean, we've always been running behind the user needs, but with all the new technologies, users have new expectations, and luckily there's also new opportunities. So one of the challenges is to match those two and to find a good synergy and to have, let's say, better data for better informed users. Another important thing is trust, because it's people understand censuses, they somehow understand how sample surveys work. Here it's difficult. It's data that is out there. We try to do something with it, it's some kind of magic, and people have difficulties in accepting the magic. So it's a matter of finding, getting their trust, also of those who hold the data, of data protection agencies, and so on. So it's a shift from traditional statistics to smarter statistics, and even like trusted smart statistics. This brings us also to the quality, to the continuity of data provision. And finally, and it's maybe the most important thing, it's the skills. It's the skills to use all this data. It's also the skills to understand this data at the end of the production line. The person in the office who has to use his data for his or her decisions in policy, in business, and so on. So there's a shift from, we've always been like collecting data via surveys, and now all of a sudden we have to connect data. So also on the side of the statisticians, we need new skills. Luckily, we have people who have these skills already. They are here. I think we have quite an interesting panel, and also quite a complementary panel. There's people from the private sector, from research, from government bodies. I will not present everybody one by one, because I think it's best that everybody presents themselves. So what we tried to do was that every speaker, every panelist has just a few minutes to introduce themselves and their work, just to position a bit why they are in the panel. And then we will go to the panel discussion and to a discussion with the entire group. So I think that, Fernando, you wanted to start. I think most people have prepared a short presentation, except for Fernando, who will just make a short oral introduction.
Bueno, muy bien. Thank you. Empiezo yo, efectivamente.
I'll start. 3 minutes for a short introduction. I'm the president at Sehidu, probably you know, but in case you don't know, this is a public entity reporting to the Ministry of Tourism for tourism, trying to promote innovation and technology in the tourism sector, both private and public. We have 8,000 councils in Spain. We have 80,000 plus companies, 360,000 companies working on tourism. We learn from others. We share with others. And we have this national strategy together with destinations and regions. We are highly devolved in Spain, and the competences fall with the regions. Spain is a leading country when it comes to tourism, that's true. But we do not just focus on today's tourism, but we want to know whether we are ready for tomorrow's tourism, the sustainable tourism. Well, that's the work for us. That's what we are doing, trying to promote digital transformation, as we discussed yesterday, where tourism is now, as the rest of the society, digital transformation of businesses and destinations both. And that is our raison d'etre. And for that, we need technology. We cannot focus merely on technology. Destinations become smart destinations because of the people. If you focus on technology, you will fail. But if you don't use technology, you will also fail. And that is our, as I said, raison d'etre. It's not about having a digital business anymore, but having your business ready for the digital world that already exists and that is coming. And in order to have our destinations ready in Spain, we have many destinations, but we also have a full inclusive strategy as set by the minister earlier today. But it's a complete strategy, and that's what matters. Big data is just part of the strategy that we need to be clear about. And in Spain, our strategy includes a given methodology and also a diagnosis, a strategic planning. This is all standardized, and that's important when it comes to data, and big data standards matter. Also, tourism intelligence systems and information systems, we need to discuss that because we refer to big data, but let's be honest. We get tourism of all kinds, A through Z, and big data is B, but we need to start with an A. Maybe information systems should be our A to get information and produce it. And then governance. Governance is so very important for tourism, and also data governance and the tools for funding of all our projects. If we actually want to have a country-wide strategy or a platform-wide strategy, and just to include some challenges or goals around data, as indicated by Christoph, that somehow can fuel our debate or discussion. AI is coming. I studied 20 years ago, and I discussed AI back then. But AI is now coming because we have data. We have real-time data. We have real-time communication systems, and we have a wonderful computing capacity for the cloud or the cell phone, wherever. And so it will impact us so very much. And data quality is key. We talk about data, but not so much about quality. And one of the main tasks ahead of us is to discuss data quality. Data is new oil, true, but oil is underground. We need to mine it, refine it, transport it all the way to the engine, fuel engine, which is now translated into machine learning. It's such a long journey. And then privacy. We administrators need to be careful with privacy and data. Businesses think that if it's not anonymized data, it's another business opportunity. But we need to understand that data could be our kids' data. And we need to deal with them the same way as if they were our children's. And then ethics, which is also essential. We will also talk about biometrics. We get more and more biometric data revolving around security at airports. So whenever we talk about providing services and also image recognition services, we need to have biometric data included. And in that regard, security, safety and security in data management are paramount. Actually, the main reason for which a family doesn't visit a country is the lack of physical security or safety. But cybersecurity, I'm certain now, will be quite significant if data are lost, for example, at a hotel brand. That is a reputational risk. And data safety and security and tourism handle so many sensitive data. But this is also very important. I hope I'm in time.
Nice and visual. Thanks for having kicked off the presentations. I think the next person who will introduce his work is David Zarcia, if that's correctly pronounced. So please.
Great. Thank you very much for being here. I'm trying to be really short, because otherwise Christoph is going to kill me. I'm really happy to be here, because I think I have one of the most amazing jobs, which is travel industry together with advertising, and this, everybody knows what's the challenges that especially nowadays destinations are facing when it comes to using the right technology, the right data to target the right user, and how to measure the incremental passenger that, for example, gets to that specific destination. So back in the days, DMOs and or airports, let's say destinations in general, were doing actions of branding when all the data that we nowadays have wasn't there, wasn't available. So I work for Travel Audience. I coordinate, which is part of the Amadeus Group, as today our head of destinations, Brigitte, mentioned. I coordinate the DMO projects, the advertising projects for DMO from start to finish, from the campaign management to the business intelligence to the optimization and reporting. Travel Audience is it's one of the advertising capabilities that Amadeus is offering. Amadeus is the engine of the travel industry. Amadeus is the big data player of the travel industry. And thanks to this, we have a massive amount of data that is available. Is here right now, and we're able to use it. We're able to empower also the DMOs and the destinations to use the data in the right way. Just to give you a couple of examples, we receive more than 2 billion consumer data points or information points or let's say travel signals a day. This is a massive amount of information that we collect and we gather from the let's say all our partners, all the ecosystem of OTAs, meta searches, airlines, and all the partners that we have in the travel industry. And this helps us to, again, empower the destinations to use the data in the right way. Just trying to be quick. Yes. This is just a couple of examples of our partners. So we have some OTAs. We have one of the latest partnership that we did with Dubai Tourism. And as well, this is very relevant to here at this specific time. Canary Islands is one of our partners, one of the biggest partners as well. And as well, they won a lot of prizes in terms of digital innovation. For DMOs. Just reconnecting back to what Christoph was saying about the kind of strange behavior or let's say multi-device, multi-channel behavior that the user has from start to finish. Actually, he was mentioning when the user is that specific destination. But let's keep in mind that the user behavior is really strange and is really irregular when it comes to searching for a trip, booking. Let's say from searching for a trip to the booking, it goes from the meta searches to the OTA. It goes to let's say I don't know, travel blogs and Lonely Planet, and then goes back to Last Minute and then to Skyscanner. So the power of our technology right now, which is an end-to-end technology, is developed in-house. Everything is done in-house. The algorithm is in developed in-house. Everything is done by us. We are able to impact the user at every stage, every, let's say, stage of the funnel, the marketing funnel. And this is one of the biggest strengths that travel audience has. So just to give you a very quick example, user is searching on for a specific destination, like, for example, Thailand. It goes to meta search and goes social ads, so on Facebook, for example. So social platforms, so on Facebook, for example, then goes back to the OTA. Then it goes back to the meta search and then sees an ad. Let's say it sees an ad from the beginning, like thanks to our technology. And this is how we start to influence the user. So it goes from Thailand to then Korea. We are promoting in the specific example, like Central Japan, which is one of the latest partner that we have in collaboration with Last Minute. And you see that the funnel, let's say the process of searching and then booking is really complex. And finally, the user, after multiple searches in different channels, different devices as well, ends up booking that specific destination that we are promoting. Okay. Thanks to all the data that we have, and thanks to the the data that we have from the searches to the booking in our ecosystem, we are then able to measure the actual incremental passenger that gets to the specific location that we are promoting. This is another example of geolocation, and more specific, Amadeus has invested in companies that allow us to target as well, to geolocating the user whenever, not just from the search to the booking, but also when the user is already there in that specific location or destination, to promote several activities on the spot. The data, the education of a destination, the education of a DMO, when it comes to using the data in the right way, is really complex, as far as I'm concerned. So this is why we, in the Amadeus group, promote courses, education, trainings for all the people and the destinations, and also students, et cetera, that want to kind of deep down and know how to use the data in the travel industry. So we give courses. Universities are two of the partners that we have. Right now, we're currently giving courses about the use of data in the travel industry. Thank you very much.
Thanks for your contribution. Oops.
I'm sorry.
And thanks for also making the link with your last slide with the need for skills also on the side of those who are supposed to be the end users. I think the next panelist who will introduce her work is Elke from Google. Please come.
Thanks, Christoph.
Ah, gracias.
Hello. My name is Elke Michelmeier, and I'm a software engineer, and I'm working for Google in Zurich, where I'm in the Google Travel project area, and I'm focusing on Google Trips app, which is a mobile app for tourists while they are on the go to visit a destination. No. Okay, let's get started. From our point of view, this panel discussion should not be called connecting devices and information, but rather we think it should be called connecting users and information, because this is one of Google's core principles. We want to focus on the user, and we want to provide tools that are helpful for them. This doesn't work. So one thing we're doing is that we run a lot of qualitative user research to find out what are the informational needs of a tourist, and how do people go about trip planning. And the tools that I would like to present in the following, they are mostly focused on trip planning and on exploration. I have a lot of screenshots, but I think given the situation with the slides, I will just try to describe what we're doing. So basically what we have travel-related content, which we can find on the web. There are texts, there are informations about places like business data listings. Here you go. Which is obviously very interesting for users, and an accurate phone number and opening hours is essential information for a tourist. And then there are pictures. We also have a community. The community is called the Google Local Guides. It's a very successful project. It has more than 50 million subscribers. And everyone can sign up and can then create reviews and ratings and can contribute facts about a place that they have been to. That's essential. They have to have actual experience with the place to be allowed to rate it. And there are two different types of questions. There are structured questions and there are also free-form questions. Based on that data, we do aggregations. And this gives us the opportunity to show interesting facts about like about the place, like when is the popular times that these places are visited? What is the review, the aggregated opinion of our users of this place, which is the review histogram. And also the facts about the place which are contributed from the people answering questions. And there are three important things to mention here when it's about user data, because what we need to be very, very careful about is user consent. So the people need to understand what we are doing with their data and they need to agree to it. Then there is user control, which means that at any time, if someone decides that they do no longer want to share their data with us and they decide to delete it using the user control applications, the data needs to go from our systems, and also all the data, everywhere where that data point was used for any derivation of it, also that needs to go. And this, if you think about a new system that uses big data, and if you build in these requirements up front, it's actually not massively complicated, but it's really, really complicated to engineer it back on. So for any startups, this is very important to think about. And the third thing is anonymization. And here it needs to be impossible to trace back to individual users from an aggregation. Okay, but once we have that, there are endless possibilities for features that are useful for tourists. I have put two examples here. One of them is a classification system for places, which can tell if the main touristic value of a place is indoors or outdoors, which is based on a machine learning model that can look at user-contributed pictures. And we also have a similar one that classifies places as kids-friendly, which is based on looking at user reviews. And on the right-hand side of this slide, you have a feature that we call day plans, or also itineraries, which is the aggregated location history of a typical tourist in a destination based on the duration they have been spending there. So we can make suggestions. For example, if you are in a place for one day, or if you are there for 3 days, these are the typical paths that tourists have been taking through the city. And here again, it's important to mention that this is a suggestion that the user can see, okay, this is what most other people have done, but then they can edit and change it according to their liking and their personal preferences. All of these features we are constantly working on and further improving, and we're also working on new features for trip planning and exploration. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Elke, for the insights in what you are doing, and it's like going to the end user perspective, the tourist himself. Can I now ask Susana to take the floor and,
Hola, sí.
So, good afternoon, everyone. I'll be very brief, trying to explain the experience where we are now in Andalusia. Following the mandate from the European Commission sent to every territory in the European Union, so that we all come together trying to develop an understandable and shared strategy for tourism and basically data access, and then other derivatives that I'll explain in a minute. We've recently, well, some 5 months ago, we've developed a platform, which is a smart platform for digitization and safety and security for tourism. This is a partnership that Andalusia belongs to, and it's leading the sector of digitization from the public sector perspective. We are co-leaders together with Lapland and Slovenia for security, safety and security. We're the top experts, actually. And then we also have a cooperation with other regions. As you can see on the map, we have regions from Spain as well, coordinated by Nestor, which is a region network, European region network, bringing together 33 regions that represent a huge percentage of tourism flowing through the European Union. On this platform, the three main pillars or areas that we'll be focusing on are access to data. Second stage would be focusing on green mobility, accessibility, connectivity. A third one that would be much more focused on looking into resilience, new phenomena, climate change, and change management, also called crisis that we find in Europe and that we need to tackle. Also, as a result of safety and security and climate change as well. This all will help us share experiences with every region. This is not concluded. So all those regions where you think that you can contribute to the platform, please join in. But actually, this is a PPP platform, and that's its calling, public-private cooperation. And there are large companies who are very much interested in sharing their experience as part of this lab. And from there onwards, each of us would need to transfer from region to region and company to company belonging to it what our knowledge is and have a large experience at a larger scale that would be supranational. I figure this kind of platform somehow fills in for this difficulty. I think throughout the conference, at least that's what I feel, is, well, there's plenty of technology. All technologies offered are amazing, and yet comes with its individuality or specificity. Then every region and territory, they are trying to have their own solution for access to data. Our proposal would be to have a true partnership experience amongst regions. As I was saying, we focused on access to data. And the goal for us there, right now, is to build kind of a lab where we will manage to define jointly what we would like tourism to look like tomorrow from the point of view of digitization and safety and security, based on the data that we need to use, for which we need to have a tourism indicator system, sustainable tourism indicator system, that needs to be good quality so that we can measure ourselves through the indicators, see how we are evolving, where we are headed. Then naturally, we need to have a constant ongoing dialogue, not just with institutions that have something to say in the sector of statistics. Actually, they have all the words there. But we also need to have a private discussion with private companies, and so that whatever we are measuring is related to the activities.
logically, Eurostat is very much interested to have big data well integrated, and so that we then have very, very clear guidelines of where we want to go. That is, not just getting all data and doing not very much with it, but rather selecting those that will help us with decision making, both in the public and in the private spheres. Another area has to do with setting up fora so that we can work on geolocation, on georeferencing, on better data management. Another important area is something we're doing already, which is a project hub, thanks to European funding, and so that hub will help improve our expertise. So you can see how we are gathering a lot of knowledge. And what is my region doing now? Well, in southern Spain, Andalusia has public funding that we are devoting to projects in cities with over 100,000 inhabitants, where we have purchased data from different sources so that the city councils, the local governments, and the businesses can then make better decisions to manage tourist destinations, not just from a quantitative, but also from a qualitative point of view. We are keeping a very, very close eye on over tourism and tourism phobia, also reputation of destinations, making sure that destinations that are doing well don't dig their own grave, because we live in a hyper-connected world, and we have to be very, very careful with what we do, do things right or along the way, because that will pave our future, the decisions we make. So in Andalusia, we have a public-funded system that is also very, very close to SMEs. Just to give you an idea of how things work in my region, which is very similar in other areas in Europe, we have some 95% of tourist companies which are SMEs. And public institutions have a responsibility there. We need to give them a hand with technologies and with data. That's all from me, and I will be very happy to answer any questions you may have later on during the Q&A session.
Many thanks, Susanna, for having shared your experience and background and what's happening in Andalusia. I think you mentioned already one important point, which is the importance of having partnerships, which can also lead to some kind of standardization instead of doing everybody doing the same things in their own corner in their own country. And I'm sure we will come back to this later on. But first, we have two more panelists to introduce themselves. Please be brief, because we have we already reached like half of the time of this session. I think Santi Gonzalez is next. And we will get the point of view from the mobile network operator, more or less.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for all. Well, I have to change a little bit my speech because I saw the rest of speakers, and I think it's better to introduce myself in a short time, and then my company, what is Synergy Partners, and then try to put now the point of the future movements in Synergic. So I am a data scientist, I am senior data scientist, I am director of innovation, director of security, director of partnership, and blah, 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 blah. Okay. Yeah, I'm very restless. And I am from Synergy Partners. And what is Synergy Partners? It's a consultants company, but it's not the typical consultants company. We try to make value from the data of our customers. That is, okay, use all the data from our colleagues and try to merge with the data of our customer in terms of value in order to improve and enhance the strategy value of their data. That is like, okay, if we want to make a more efficient city, why don't we can connect the data from the governments and the data from Google, from Amadeus, from Iberia, these kind of things. This is not the typical consultants because the 70% of the people are technicians like me. This is not typically a consultant. Most of them are data scientists as me, with based on mathematics, statistics, computer science, telco, these kind of things. We try to move in around all the industries, so we have experience in all the possible verticals issues. So we can use different ideas in a vertical that could be useful also in another vertical way. We try to move in around all the data value pyramid. Like is we can create infrastructure, of course we can, and we can create strategies trying to make a digital transformation of a city. Yeah, but for us, the important thing here is our bot. We have bought by Telefonica and, from 2015, and after that, we are an independent company, but together with Telefonica, with the data of Telefonica, and also with the data of our colleagues, and of course, with the data of our customers, we can merge and we can create something that is unknown, something that has value, in order to get a profit. And this is our focus. And this is why we are now one of the most important big data companies around the, Europe. That due to all the things we change when we take into account in big data problems, we need to separate, we have to create different departments inside of Synergic. First of all, we need consultants, the typical consultant person that try to view the paradigm of a company and try to make a good business strategy for a company. Of course, we need persons which are the architects that create, they're not the typical architects, the linear architects. This is the infrastructure persons that try to make an efficient machine for put all the data inside. Also, we have the people that transform the data and process the data in order to make future knowledge. And of course, we have people who create these models, the analytical models, the artificial intelligence models, and the people who visualize and create visualization, interactive visualization, in order to use in the future. Also, we can connect. We want to connect all the devices created by Telefonica and or other partners in order to move all the data in the same way, try to converse. And of course, we try to teach all the things, all the knowledge we have, we try to teach to our customers. Well, we are one of the only partner of Columbia University, and we are partners of practically all the Spanish universities, UPN, Carlos III, La Laguna, Coruña, Valencia, and so on. The idea is to merge innovation from universities and innovation in business in order to get the best solution in a short time. That's why we continue publishing papers. We continue going to congresses, of course. And we, well, we collaborate in VDD and so on in Strata, and that's it. And in terms of the things we have to talk now, we take some, I take some ideas that Fernando present us, like calidad de datos, data quality, artificial intelligence, privacy, ethics. And I want to put more, like MDM, I don't know if you know, master data management, which is try to normalize all the data, not normalize only the institutions, also the data is important to normalize. Also the data is important to know the origin and the transformation of the data along the time. And one important thing for us also is open data, open innovation, and try to go with the legal part. You know, the GDPR, the horrible commitment we have to accomplish in Europe, is very difficult to accomplish in this way with the data we created. So our work also is try to join that, get the model, get our result, and try to get the result without problems in legal part. So finally, our strategy is one concept, trying to create a heuristic intelligence center that tries to connect the concept of big data, the concept of smart cities, and the concept of safety city, and try to connect everything in order to solve the possible problems that the residents and the tourists want. And that's all for me. Thank you.
Many thanks. Before opening the panel discussion, let's quickly move to the last speaker, Federico Esper from Argentina, who also brings his experience as a, let's say, tourism data researcher in the Argentinian Tourism Board.
Ahí se escucha mejor, sí. Buenos días.
Good evening. My presentation will be up on the screen hopefully soon, but in the meantime I would like to thank the UNWTO and everybody in the room who's here at this time. I think saying something new is not going to be an easy task, which is why I decided to tell you a little bit about the tourist intelligent system that we now have running, up and running in the city of Buenos Aires. This is a tourist intelligence system that has been designed and developed by us in the city of Buenos Aires in Argentina together with Segitur. And I would like to really thank Fernando de Pablo's team, Carlos Romero, Fernando, everybody who has worked so hard to make this possible, and also with the support of the Tourism Ministry in Argentina. My name is Federico Esper. I'm in charge of the Tourism Observatory and Market Intelligence Department in my city. Which is the main challenge in this field? Well, we know that we have access to a huge amount of information. How can we simplify matters so that it's user-friendly and practical, so that anybody can understand how to work with it, whether it's a university professor, a consultant in tourism, a hotel manager, or even just a citizen who lives in the city and who's thinking of being an entrepreneur and do something in the field of tourism. That's the main challenge we're finding at the moment. I would like to just show you three small details about our system. But before I do so, I would like to say the answer to the question is big data. But we first need to ask the right answer, the right questions. For instance, if we talk about international tourists, well, we first need to ask the right questions. How many tourists get to Buenos Aires from abroad? What do they want? What do they need? If we talk about tourist mobility, there we have mobile telephony data. We need to know which areas and neighborhoods are most popular. Then hotel managers need to know about their competitors, hotel room prices, and so on. If we think about visitors, we need to understand their profile for booking preferences, for different stops during the way, during their journey. And as I said, I've just brought three small examples just for you to get an idea of what we're doing. I didn't bring a PowerPoint presentation. This is a direct access to our website. I said the challenge, the main challenge, was making something that's really hard look dead easy. This is the map of the city of Buenos Aires. And here we can see the different neighborhoods and districts in the city. This is information about the month of July, and this is a Monday at 8 p.m. You can see how, as time goes by, we see how many international tourists are in this city, in the different neighborhoods, Obelisk area, Recoletas, Retiro, the different districts. And depending on the time of the day and the day of the week, the heat map changes colors. And also, we can see potential areas that should be developed and promoted. This would be for international tourists in this case, but we also have this information for Argentinian tourists or visitors, and also for residents, which is not so useful for us in tourism, but it is very important for public transport or for urban development. You can see at different times of the day and then different days of the week, we have certain areas which are very, very busy with international visitors. We also have the possibility of viewing the map for a particular event, for a conference, for a sports event. We can check the map and the heat map, and we would have similar information thanks, as I said, to the mobile telephony information. Those are information cubes, we call them, providing us information or tourist intelligence. We have red there in the obelisk area. That means that's a very busy area at that time on that particular day. During the night, it shows very, very clearly that Palermo is the area for people to go out. And then for a restaurant, for somebody who wants to promote their restaurant, they would be able to check and see how Brazilian tourists tend to have dinner in which area of the city. Or, for instance, if you have a bicycle rental company and you want to target American tourists, they would find that they mostly visit a particular district. That's micro-segmentation for micro-politics. That's where big data can really help. This is what we have defined as tourist micro-politics. and policies. What about pricing? Well, we have information, again, for the different districts, and you can run a benchmark study also with other cities, our competitors. One is Lima, and the other one is Santiago de Chile. So we have the location of hotels in Buenos Aires, in Lima, and Santiago for the different numbers of stars and categories. You can see on the left Buenos Aires, the map showing that particular district I mentioned earlier that was very much bright red. You can see that's where most of the hotels are located as well. And last but not least, my third example. You see, hotel price, room prices, travelers, and trends. And the third example is airline bookings. We have information from Asia, well, from a number of different cities and travelers coming to Buenos Aires. We have then information about dates of the booking and the traveling and trends that can be observed. Each information cube is has a lot of detail. I've just given you very specific examples just to give you an idea of how it works. So, finally, let me finish with a particular cube of information that we are designing right now, which is reviews and opinions of tourists and visitors about restaurants in particular. Buenos Aires is a very gastronomical city with lots of different categories and types of food, which we have in great detail on the map of the city, with reviews and ratings for restaurants and hotels. So when we talk about local management, if we're thinking about promoting a particular area, we should understand what the supply is, but also the demand, current demand for that area. We're also working on something that we talk the sentimental management of emotions. For instance, when the review is good for a particular hotel, then we ask them, what is it that's good? Is it the facilities or breakfast? Or why was breakfast so brilliant? Because you liked the coffee or the carpet color? Or what is it? That's all from me. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks for showing us that that it actually works, because if many people think big data is just lots of blah blah, but you showed a nice dashboard that probably helps you in the day-to-day decision making. One thing I learned is that 7 times 3 minutes is not 21, but it's closer to 55 minutes. But still, we got lots of interesting insights from the panelists, and they were right. It's difficult to explain all the work they are doing in just a few minutes. But I hope we can still take some time for a discussion. Federico's game starts only at 8 o'clock, Nigeria, Argentina, so there's still time. He's not in a rush. And while he's here, he's not stressing. So let's bear with him. Maybe one thing, and maybe I would address the first topic to maybe to the users, more to Susanna, or also to you. After the presentations, and of course also with the baggage you brought here, there are many like very well-known data gaps. Where do you see like the quick applications, the low-hanging fruits in using big data to make some kind of really small revolution with a minor investment or input in all the big data sources that exist? Where do you think that you can get some quick wins? I don't know if you want to start or if you want to start. Or anybody else from the panel? I was just thinking these are the two people that who come from more from the user perspective.
Well, that's a pretty hard question, or I find it hard to answer. from a public, the point of view of a public institution, I think the trick might be gathering as much collective intelligence as we possibly can. Because we all have similar problems, right? Many destinations have similar challenges. We have scarce resources, and another massive problem in tourism is that we don't get together, we don't join forces, we don't associate with other partners. And learning from others is great. That's what we're doing here at the conference. For instance, listening to Federico, that was a very practical example that I've really learned from. It's a great way for a city to then be able to make decisions. You're helping businesses in the city, guiding them and giving them information for them to make decisions as well. So what can we do? Well, we need to talk to one another. We need participate in more platforms, join forces, and have systems so we can efficiently measure what we're doing. Rather than going from A to B to C and testing different technologies, each and every one of us individually, that's not the way. I think we need to join forces, get together, and then have a strategy and get it going.
Of this type of cooperation, it's often projects that are too small for one region or one destination, but by joining forces, not only joining forces and knowledge, also budgets, of course, you can bring things together.
Sí, yo como para agregar lo que decía mi colega.
I would like to add something after listening to my colleague, because there's no doubt big data is the way forward. But then public institutions have to decide how we can help residents and their quality of life. When I say residents, I'm talking about citizens at large and businesses, not just businesses that work in tourism, but businesses in general, because we have more and more information. And then the challenge is transforming information into knowledge so that people's quality of life can improve, so that businesses and entrepreneurs can make a profit and can have profitable businesses. I think that's the real challenge for big data. Talking to Fernando, we were saying this earlier on, because this is a field where we're learning all the time. It's continuous learning and improvement. As we analyze information, we learn more and better. And then public institutions have to use this information not just to help the tourism sector, but to help develop the city in a balanced manner. Also helping with mobility and traffic, all of that has to feed into the system and not just focus on tourism. Sometimes the tourist industry is a little bit endogamic, just thinking about itself. We have to have a broader vision and improve the quality of life of both residents and visitors. That's right, because your question was basic for public institutions and for us to collaborate with other stakeholders. How can we optimize the resources we have and not end up with everybody doing the same thing and not collaborating? I think that's basic, not just in Spain, but in general. And our minister mentioned this morning, maybe there should be a network of destinations. Well, we think we should improve governance as well in technologies and big data in tourism. That means having technological committees, standardizing data, because data costs money, right? We need to have maybe a center for technologies or where information can be reused so that success stories can be used in other areas. And this morning we were talking about how we could define a governance system for big data, not just for Spain, but internationally as well, with standardized semantics. And again, standardization is at the core of what we need to do. And then also, I was thinking, sometimes we talk about platforms with very general data. And what about local data that have to do with a particular destination management? We need to talk about the back office in destination management. We need to be able to access the back office where a city manages its data. For instance, if we want to access information for a particular museum, right, and use them, right. So we're now focusing on big data and intelligence systems, which is right. Well, let's make the most of it so that we can optimize resources which are very scarce.
Indeed, cooperation is extremely important. So we've talked a bit about the side of the users, already cooperating in terms of needs of what we can get out of the data. I think you're waiting to take the floor exactly on the topic that I'm going to mention, and it was mentioned in the presentations as well. It's the, let's say, the urgency of standardization. Because what you are doing with the Telefonica data might be similar to what somebody else in another country is doing with their mobile network operator data, but not identical. So already in Europe, we try to take initiatives to bring the MNOs together and even the users, the statisticians together to set up standards. So I would like to have your opinion as well on this, and maybe also afterwards from the colleagues who work in Travel Audience and the colleague from Google. You have the microphone.
I will try to say something that is based in what Fernando said, and also try to explain a little bit more about normalization and standardization based on information from anywhere. First of all, you say that we have to collaborate, but we have to take into account about the sources of information we usually use. We use information, our information created for us, information from hotels, for agencies, and from social networks. Be careful with social networks. I don't know if you know, or probably you know, what is fake news. Fake news is like, okay, I can write whatever I want. I can write that his hotel is horrible, and it's not really horrible. It's incredible hotel, but my hotel is close to them. So I put one remark, what horrible remark, and nobody say anything about that. We have to take into account that this thing is used for all of us. So we have to detect these kind of things and discard. How? Probably it's too early to work in that. But the thing is, be careful with the data, because all the data has not the same value. Mm-hmm. It's one of the typical V's in big data. Okay? And the other thing is, try to use a normal data as from the beginning, the source of the data. Okay, I can't publish the Telefonica data. I can't, it's impossible. Because, of course, I know the person who called or the person who moved from one side to the other. I have to aggregate, I have to create some segments, some clusters of people, some clusters of location, as Google use. And the idea is, why don't we can merge in the same normalization, in the same aggregation, in the same rules? Why don't we can't create the same language as SQL? SQL is a standard language. Why don't we can create a standard language for tourists, and for residents also? Because remember that the first of all is the residents. Then our tourists and our Spanish tourists, the Spaniards, tourists, that probably is the different thing than the rest of tourists. And then, of course, all the people. But first of all, residents. I don't know if...
David, do you want to add something?
Yeah. I mean, Christoph, I think this, as far as troll audience is concerned in this specific question, I mean, all my colleagues have very right points regarding standardization of the data that is used in that specific location when or let's say that also allows to make better processes, better clusters, et cetera, et cetera. So our, let's say our strength in the sense is to empower the destinations with certain data that help them to kind of in the prior process, you know, before that the user like actually gets to that destination. So how we standardize this again, as I said before, is we search for that specific user that has a travel intent, which is like a clear travel intent of that location together with the competing destinations, and this is how we, let's say, boost or trying to influence the user that is likely to also consider the other destination. So just to give a couple of like a practical example, because you know we talk about the big data and travel intents and stuff, but giving a practical example is a lot better. So if we have a user, again, Amadeus is looking at all the data that we have that is in the travel industry, and there's users that are interested in a specific destination like Thailand or Indonesia. So this user, when searches multiple times, then can also be interested in another destination if this destination is showed to the user. And this is when he start considering. Then he talks to the his wife or his or her husband, and then start considering the destination. And then after, let's say, a long or short process, depends, usually it's like within the 30 days, makes the final booking to that, eventually to that destination that is promoted. So for us, more is to, let's say, empower the destinations of, you know, with a specific data that might be useful for them and how to measure from start to finish the, let's say, throughout the funnel, the booking process.
Okay. Elke, I see you already took the microphone, Lisa. And maybe if you, now that you have the floor, maybe also if you could say something linking your work to what, to the comment about the, I mean, not so much about the fake reviews, but the, like, the selectivity bias of people who do leave comments, who do leave reviews, because you try, in what you showed, you try to offer a product and insights and information to people, but it's channeled from, I mean, it's like crowdsourced via other users, which might be where there may be a selectivity bias. So maybe if you also want to give some insight in how you deal with this at Google.
I answer that one first.
Okay.
So as I said before, in our case, the review is somewhat verified because we know from location history that the user has been to the place that they then rate and review, which I think already helps to have a higher quality of the data. But obviously, it's still possible that someone just had a bad day or typed the wrong letters, or anything can happen pretty much. But as long as we have enough data points, it will be possible to aggregate it and to have the majority represent the actual public opinion of the place. Okay. So in that respect, I'm less worried. I think this is a problem that can be solved.
Yep.
Okay. In terms of the overall system where different participants will share their data, this is a much more complicated question. I think it needs an incremental approach. I liked very much what Fernando said about the network of destinations, because I think in this case it's possible to share a lot of infrastructure and knowledge and also people who, because many questions they need the same type of technology for every destination. So I think that's a really good idea. But then there would still be external data that would be contributed, and once that happens, the question is how to cross-reference it. And then the solution was would be something that the hackathon winner spoke before, because he was talking about ontologies and how they can help to model pretty much any kind of object that is in the world. And I think a simplified solution would be needed to be able to model what is a hotel, what is my tourist attraction, what, how far is it between those places, how many people can stay in what hotel, and to collect all that information in a structured way, which is obviously a major effort. And then all the contributors would need to know the system of which references are used. So if I want to contribute data about a certain business, I need to know how can I find the ID of that business. So it's very challenging, but this is it's possible to do. And I've been thinking about, because I think such a system, it needs to have a certain, we need to know which kind of question should it answer, which kind of purpose should it serve. So the first thing would need to be thinking about what should the system be able to do in the end. And I've come up with two possible use cases that I think would be still extremely challenging, but maybe good first steps. And one of them would be to try and all work together to have accurate business listings about places. So that would be like tourist attractions and also hotels and so on, all the telephone numbers and the business listing information could be kept accurate with all kinds of people being able to contribute. And I think another thing that would be really interesting to do would be to do to try and see from all those different systems that we've been hearing about, because many of them, they count the number of tourists in a place. Mm-hmm. And if that is highly aggregated, it's possible to share this data. And then we would be kind of seeing the problem through many different lenses, because I'm pretty sure that the number of the different numbers from the different systems about this is how many tourists I think are in this country at this place would be different, simply because the systems that are used to collect that information are very different. And the real answer would be kind of the average of all those systems.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
One other thing. There is another ways to know the mobility of the tourist. I don't know if anyone uses the beacons connectivity. If the government puts some beacons that is typically Wi-Fi connection or Bluetooth connection, we can know where the tourist is, and we can create some movements along the time in order to know where is the tourist and where will be the tourist in the future, depending on the segment.
Okay. Thanks. There were many things that came out of your presentation and discussion, and there's many things we could still discuss, but I would like to pick just one more before we also take a few questions from the rest of the people, because we're seven, but there's a few more people. No, I would have loved to talk also about it was mentioned, the ethics, the access to data, the business models to access data, I mean, the partnerships between users and producers to access the data. It was also mentioned the privacy issues, the anonymization. There's lots of work being done on not so much sharing data, but like mutually using data with the secure multi-party computation and so on. But there's one more thing before I give the floor to some people in the audience, is we didn't touch on the stage the topic of the skills, like what kind of organizational changes are needed to use this data at the side of even of the data owners, because we often see that there's people who have a vast amount of data, be it mobile network operators, credit card companies, who really don't know how to exploit it, who don't know what skills they need to exploit it, and also on the side of the users, because designing a survey, it's not the same as connecting all these different pieces of a puzzle into a meaningful, like this kind of dashboard that you presented. So I would be interested to hear your views, and I think you're all concerned from either side of your experience on this topic. So I don't know who wants to start. It's basically the skill gaps you see, the shortages you see to basically hire people to understand this. it's something from the past, because we have this thing called tourism satellite accounts, which is a macroeconomic approach to the economic dimension of tourism. But we see that countries who do produce it in the ministries and the tourism boards, they often don't find people to actually exploit the data, to use the data. Now with big data, it's something similar happening. It's no longer like simple two-dimensional tables, but it's a much more, it's like Fernando explained it, it's like, well, the whole process of finding the oil to actually driving a destination or a car with the oil.
Sí, si quieres puedo comentar.
Sure, I can make a comment on that. Learning has been intense or heavy and complicated. It is a journey we're taking with Sergitur and our tourism department, seeing how to tap on information. As for providers, as for cell telephony, especially for Latin America, there are some destinations that are underdeveloped. There are not so many cases for a city where in Latin America they're using this kind of information. So we actually had to define what a tourist is. Telefónica has the information on people that connect to the network with roamers, but we actually had to define what a tourist is. And this was so basic, and yet it took us so very long. Not for us to know what a tourist is, because we only got the recommendations by the UNWTO and other international entities that has to do with the habitual residents and source and destination. Because if it's 40 kilometers away, but they commute every day, that's not a tourist. And so there's a number of nights, do you need to stay somewhere? And also distance is to be considered. So it was complicated methodologically, but it still had to be determined. And so the model given to us was not actually the information we needed. Now we find ourselves in a position where we can actually compare big data information and traditional source information, statistical information, such as international tourism survey at airports and other entry points to the country, but with the standardization of data. That was the starting point. And probably, company has learned a lot from us. I'm certain about that.
Ahora. Bueno, yo estoy totalmente de acuerdo con lo que...
Yes, I fully agree with what our colleague is saying. It is true that for Spain and Europe, providers or carriers are much more used to giving some kind of information that we can find useful when managing tourism. But I really care about the approach that you said, the user's approach. How they will be handled the information. With Andalusia's experience as a region for smart data strategy, that's Andalusian strategy. Well, we have a training program that is necessarily linked to it. It's pointless to have all these elements and then the users will not know how to use it. So it would be pointless. So it's about teaching. It's all about teaching these data transformation. This is a breakthrough, it's a change, and not everyone is equally developed. We might all know how to use a phone, a device, and yet maybe not everyone has the same level of command to interpret how or what they can do with the information they are gathering. So, in Andalusia, we're doing so, and undoubtedly, the experience I shared here with a platform, which is Safety, Security, and Digitation platform, for the first stage, that is access to data, and also having the top lab, which is a lab where we can design this idea of tourism. So we're thinking that not just virtually, but probably we could have a physical presence, we can have a physical space where they move around, and everyone is trained and educated, because in the end, those are the individuals we're talking about that need to have a knowledge standard in order to handle all this information. And so we finally reach the same goals and fulfill the same goals. So empowerment is basic.
Yeah, so I just wanted to add from the provider perspective in this case, which is a bit different. Like, I agree completely with what Susan is saying. So the digital transformation is really hard for, and it's a very long process, especially when it comes to destinations. In this case, we see that from our experience in Amadeus and travel audience, like airlines are very advanced when it comes to measuring, when it comes to tracking, etc. Digital transformation for destinations is a bit more complex because of the infrastructure and what's and also historically. This is where I think for a destination is extremely important to partner with a provider like Amadeus Travel Audience to use the right data and in the meantime be educated on how to use the data and how to use this big data and to kind of progress. So digital transformation is a long process, but where when the destination and partner with a powerful partner and a trustworthy partner, I think it's the key right now.
Okay. I wanted to open the floor for the audience, but I see Fernando takes the floor. So we will.
Solo un momento para interrumpir. Es verdad, la transformación digital.
It is true. Digital transformation, it's a complicated, time-consuming process. It's not a one-off action. And actually, recall this sentence, digital transformation, actually, this is a quote I read somewhere. It is change-resistant because it means that professionals that were overbearing and very useful for a corporation, and they need to understand they need to work differently and work with technologies that they are not familiar with for their corporation, their organization to stay competitive. So this is closely related to digital skills that you discussed, and not just digital skills when it comes to using technology, but also you mentioned another topic that is methodologies, measurement methodologies. True, we moved from survey-based methodologies to methodologies that could be data-based, clearly, but it involves a clear change that maybe Estonia or Malaysia, but that would be it, and not many more countries. And then shortly, let me mention everything that is legal. We talk about data inclusion or embedding, but we also need to consider all the ideas with the data protection regulation. So it's not just one source, but several sources of information where you bring them together, and granularity may take you to a defect or a lack of compliance of the regulation. So the legal aspect of it is important, even if the data are anonymized.
Thanks for sharing this as well. We more or less have to close, but you've all been listening to the panel for more than an hour, so I think you at least deserve to also have the chance to ask a few questions. They asked us to close like in 3-4 minutes, so if you have a question or another topic you want to raise, I see somebody raising her hand. Yeah. Please briefly introduce yourself and ask the question. And to the panel, if you answer the question, please be as short as possible so we can maybe take another question afterwards. Yes, please.
Wait. Hola, ¿qué tal? Bueno, me ha parecido extraordinario.
Hi, I really loved all your presentations. I'll summarize. Data management. You refer to, but not so much about processing large databases. As you know, there's a high volume of data there, but it comes with a cost, high cost. I'd like to know, what about speed and veracity, data authenticity and cost to keep up with the process and processing? What about democratization of big data in a way that private and public partners can have access to data, but then people, regular people as well, ordinary people for transparency reasons. And finally, And this one goes for Elke. What about machine learning? How could it replace at some point the use of so much staff for data reading, because it takes a lot of effort? So how can be humans replaced with machine learning?
Okay. I don't know who wants to. Do you want to start with the last one, Elke? Please be short for your voice.
The problem is that I didn't fully understand the question, but I think the question is if machine learning will replace humans soon. And I think the answer is no.
I don't know who wants to address the first one on the large volume of data, how to process this, how to manage, how not to drone in the data.
In Spanish, okay?
Yeah.
To be shortly.
Computational cost now is very low thanks to solutions such as Microsoft, Amazon, Google, and automation of all of that. That's basic. Actually, the serverless philosophy, so the machine doesn't exist anymore. What it offers is just a cleaning and data processing service, which is highly scalable based on the data volumetrics that you have. That's the solution. How do we tackle it, the problem? The more machines we have running in parallel, the lower the cost, and has been proven. It is that's not the problem, neither virtually nor physically. As for data democratization, we are a public partner, and our platform will be made available online, open to anyone who is willing to subscribe using a username and a password. And access will be free of charge. So public sector is the one investing on human resources. So it's our own resources, it's in-house development. We buy information for some of the cells or cubes that you saw. Some other are ours, and some others are in accordance with public bodies. And democratization means the way they will be using information as well. It will be used online on the website, and there will be training and educations and roadshows for chambers of commerce and business associations, so that they know what we have, so that they can use information and that they give us feedback on new indicators, new questions that we might reply to with the large amount of information that we have.
Discussed, and also thanks for the answers. I was notified a second time that we have to stop here. So sorry if you still had questions. If you still had a question, just attack the panel before they can leave the room. Sorry for having taken more of your time, but I think most of you stayed till the very end, which probably shows that all the people have to say have to share very relevant things with us. Before closing, I would just like to thank WTO and Segetur and Asturias for organizing this and for putting this session and the panel together. I was only moderating. I was not in charge of selecting the panel. I would also like to thank the interpreters for staying with us so long. I mean, not till 6, but almost till 6:45. And of course, all of you for staying so long. So a round of applause for the panelists and for yourself.
Thank you very much, Christoph, and excellent panel. Thank you. I wonder whether when you go home tonight, you should perhaps consult what in my household we call Auntie Google, and just look at the matter of a British company called Cambridge Analytica and Facebook. Nobody. I'm amazed that nobody mentioned it, but if I go into big data, I will be a worried person all the way until we get to your point about personal involvement in the data and actually reading our own data. I think this is going to be a big story, really big story. Number two, we have people in our midst who have been walking off with the translation sets. Please, please give them in, as they are very expensive. And number three, I'm so sorry to remind you, 9:00 in the morning. And thank you so, so much for joining us today. Thank you.